When is the present?
Oh, I'm not going to fall into that trap. Who's going to say it?
Well, it's not really a trap. It is a genuine, interesting question. I mean, there are different ways of trying to describe what the present might be, but let's talk about the present in terms of archaeology. Archaeologists actually have an acronym, BP, which means before present, and they can date the present. It's an exact date, January the 1st, 1950.
That's the present?
That, for archaeologists, and there's a very good reason for this, and you might be able to work it out.
If you did,
I'd be very impressed.
Is it plastics?
Not quite that.
Bakelite?
When archaeologists... No, archaeologists are interested in the distant past. And recently, in the last 100 or so years, certain techniques have enabled us to discover... I say us, I mean... Carbon dating has allowed us to discover how old things are. Now, in the 1950s, basically, they decided by January the 1st, 1950, we had so screwed up the atmosphere with nuclear testing that no carbon dating could be trusted after January the 1st, 1950. So that is known as the present.
See, these archaeologists need to learn a bit of physics, though. Yeah. According to Einstein's theory of space and time,
yes,
which is our best theory of space and time, there's no such thing as a present moment which spans the universe, or indeed even the Earth, or in fact even two people moving relative to each other.
It is absurd to think of an event that might be happening now in a galaxy and me doing this as being simultaneous. That has no meaning cosmically, does it?
You can swap the order of them as long as they're not causally connected. I mean, we don't know how time works at a very fundamental level, actually.
But time's arrow. I mean, I actually got my head around that a bit.
Yeah.
Because you don't need maths if you think that everything's going forward and as it does, it decays.
Yes. Mm.
So that, then you understand entropy.
Yes.
I just look, for instance, all you need is an analogy to make that's pertinent to you. So in my case, all relationships. And then you realise, of course, you have a perfect 18 months and then they're dead.
The second law of... The second law of sexual dynamics.
Yes, that's how I, according to me, that's how I extrapolate.
To make it statistically significant, though, you have to have an awful lot of relationships.
Oh, I do.
That's all the
law of entropy.
What did the Pope's librarian say when he first saw the rings around the planet Saturn?
They initially thought the planet had ears.
Ah, yes.
That was Galileo. I mean, I don't think he actually thought it had ears, because Galileo was a genius.
No, he thought like a jug. Ears in the sense of a jug ears, wasn't it?
Yeah.
No, that's Galileo, who was sensible.
They are remarkable.
I'm talking about the librarian of the Pope.
Do you know...
He genuinely believed that it was possible that after Christ's ascension into heaven, the rings of Saturn were where he put his foreskin.
Ah, yes!
Now, you may think, oh, I'm trying to mock the church, this is all nonsense. But Christ, of course, was a Jewish boy, and like all Jewish boys, on the eighth day of his birth, he was circumcised.
Yeah, 50,000 miles across. Imagine
the size! They weren't aware of that.
I need a Jesus, to hang this massive foreskin on.
I've got new respect for Jesus.
That's some girl. Yeah.
His name was Leo Alatius, and his essay was called De Praeputio Domini Nostri Jesu Christi Diatriba, a diatribe, a discussion concerning the prepuce, foreskin, of our Lord Jesus Christ.
This is how to interest teenagers in astronomy. This is how I've been missing.
Is it out there as a relic?
Well, like all the relics, there are 18 places who claim to have the one true holy foreskin.
Are they really?
Christ, yes, they are. Catherine of Siena was one of the weirder of the saints. She believed that Christ gave her his foreskin as a wedding ring in their mystical marriage.
What a gift.
After her death, her hand was cut off and became a relic with its invisible foreskin on it as a ring. She was an extreme anorexic, a peculiar woman. She also actively sought out degrading experiences. She once drank a cupful of cancerous pus from a woman who had abused her. So naturally...
Has she appeared on Mock the Week?
But now, more importantly, more significantly, how were the rings around Saturn actually formed?
I'm going to play the card there.
You are right. Nobody knows. You're a true scientist. The fact is, nobody does really know, do they? There are two sort of major...
Well done.
Thank you.
Well done.
There's a Socratic acceptance of the limits of one's own knowledge, and there's ignorance. I'm not saying which is which. No, quite right. There are two major theories. I think there are two major theories, isn't
it? Yeah, it's thought there could be a moon that was either disrupted, so something hit it and fragmented it. Although they are almost pure water ice. Which, come to think of it now, sat here, makes the moon theory a bit unlikely, doesn't it? Because moons are made of rock.
So the other theory would be that it would be something to do with the formation of the planet itself, that something spun off it in some way and then achieved a stable orbit around and then formed these...
God's
and they don't
drink.
Coalesce together. They're held, the structures are held by the other moons. There are over 60 moons of Saturn.
Are they part of the rings or entirely separate from the rings?
Some of them are inside small moons called shepherd moons, which go around and you get rings in between those moons. And then it's got moons outside the rings, which affect the structure of the rings. So they orbit outside and affect it.
Quite
so it's a
moons,
very complex...
Life-carrying moons?
Well, there's a moon called Enceladus, which is about as big as Britain. It's a very small moon. But it has fountains of ice rising up out of the surface. And it's thought that means that there may well be liquid water beneath the surface, so pockets of liquid water. Everywhere on Earth that you find water, you find life.
Of all these moons, like, this is the one thing I wanted to ask you. Of all these moons, which one's most likely to be the home to Ewoks?
That would be Titan.
Titan
has got a thicker atmosphere than the Earth, so you'd need to be furry.
Good answer. We just have to destroy the one that has Jar Jar Binks on it, though. That's the what would you find at the exact centre of the observable universe?
Oh, you.
Oddly enough. Possibly.
Norfolk, yes. There isn't a centre of the universe, really. So isn't the centre of the universe just the person who's looking out? Because it must be the same...
You are so absolutely right, it hurts.
In any direction.
That's brilliant. Yeah.
Oh, absolutely right. But I remember at school them doing something with a balloon. Teacher, and he put loads of dots on a balloon, and then he sort of said it was like the closest to explaining the universe as he could do.
That's absolutely right. Although there has been an absolute statement of where the centre of the universe is, which is that it's at the meeting of Bank Street and Sixth Street in the town of Wallace, Idaho. There it is. Centre of the universe.
Is that the mayor of Idaho, though? Has he said that?
Yeah.
Well, it covers Idaho. Well for tourism and gone, why don't we just say the centre of the universe is here?
You're absolutely right. He said it because there was no particular scientific evidence to say that it wasn't.
We'll have it.
Yeah, but it's Americans like to stake a claim. They're land grabbers. It's in their... In their DNA, so to be. Yeah. Not that we weren't in our colonial era, of course.
Isn't the sun the centre of the universe?
Well, sorry, I didn't want to laugh at that.
What a way to build me confidence!
I thought that was a serious question as well. We both looked to you, and you looked at us like the peasants on the land. Will we ever be free of this tyranny? Never.
I'd like to go in the toilet, but doesn't the Wiki Hall witch live there?
Well, I'm sorry that it sounded quite so patronising. The centre of the universe is apparently Bank Street and Sixth Street in Wallace, Idaho, or
the sun.
Yes. You unutterable beasts. The exact centre of the observable universe, you'll find the unbearable lightness of Johnny Vegas or whoever happens to be observed. What was the matter with the Gilbert U238 Atomic Energy Children's Chemistry Set?
Did it have uranium in it?
It sure did.
That's what glowing green.
That's what U-238 is. Yep, absolutely. Really? It contained uranium and other sources of alpha, beta, and gamma radiation, including good, healthy polonium, which is in there. Yep. Wow. And it included a Geiger counter and instructions on how to mine for uranium. And,
wow. This is the start of the Iranian weapons program. Exactly. We had the kit.
The packaging said it was completely safe and harmless. It was sold in 1951, 1952 for $49.50, which is about £300 now.
Whoa!
So it was pricey?
It was pricey.
If you wanted your polonium even then, it cost you.
And that's why they stopped making it.
Because it was too expensive.
Well, yeah, the margins were not good enough for them to make much of a profit on it. As you see, it says along the top, another Gilbert Hall of Science product.
And it also says exciting and safe.
Yeah. That's right.
Absolutely. I'm not sure those two things go together.
They don't. Do
my friend in science dared me to eat some iron filings, and I did it. I got in a lot of trouble. Because my teacher was a magnet. No, but...
Did you then draw a beard? Did you, like, move it around?
I had to go and see the head science teacher and stand in front of the whole class and explain that I'd eat an iron filing. For about 2 years, I was the boy that ate iron filing.
That's a Channel 4 documentary. Yeah. That's fantastic. Yeah. Well, the guy responsible, who's called Alfred Carlton Gilbert, and he came up with a number of sets for children. I mean, there was a chemistry set, which contained ammonium nitrate, which is the principal ingredient for fertiliser bombs.
In other stuff, the good stuff.
Yeah, he liked to give kids exactly the good stuff.
Agent Orange.
The first experiment in that kit was to make gunpowder.
He just didn't like children, did he? But
his most famous invention is huge in America. It's the American equivalent of Meccano, which is called Erecta. And there it is. Are there giggles from our audience? It contains the word erect. Well, there you are.
They're still all smiling out there now.
What's the roundest thing in the universe?
Yep. No, just saying.
Oh, no. Oh, not at all. You should see it.
The roundest thing in the universe.
Yeah.
Ball bearings.
Ball bearings are quite round, but they're...
I swallowed a ball bearing. Roundest. You mean smoothest, most...
Well, the most purely round, in other words. Because if you... Well...
The Earth is a thingy, is it squashed? It's not round.
No, that's right, it's an oblate spheroid.
Oh, Nelly Furtado! He's got a word for everything. Is it a liquid drop, a water drop?
They can get jolly round. They can be very round. Very nice. We're actually further out of space than Earth, beyond Earth. It's a cosmic phenomenon.
Is it a black hole?
It's that kind of a deal.
Oh, it's those space helmets. Those big round helmets with the things on the top.
Is it the thing called the genius point? Is it the point to which everything goes to, ultimately?
Not that. It's when a supernova has a gravitational collapse, it turns into something called a neutron star.
No.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
The neutron star.
Yeah. They're really round.
That's not round!
No, that's not. That's a supernova, I think. That's a supernova. Going supernova.
Then show us the round thing!
He's very upset, aren't you?
Yes!
It only has a diameter of about 15 miles or so, and there isn't one near enough for you to be able to see it with the naked eye.
Have you ever noticed how we always have to take Stephen's word for it?
But what's interesting is that if I had a thimbleful of a neutron star, it would weigh more than a mountain.
Yeah, but you don't.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'll tell you what, imagine how confused the old woman darning your socks would be if you had a thimble full of it. She was just trying to fix a hole and there's all space and time coming out of a thimble. That's no way to treat the elderly.
You're right.
So you put a thimble down and no one could pick it up.
No one at all.
And when you've got a good cleaning lady, you want to hang on to them. You don't want to mess it around. I'm leaving, Mr. D. Why? Well, because of all this space business with your thimbles. I don't like it.
It might have double the mass of the sun, But it's it's only 15 miles across, roughly. And the highest mountain on it is worth 5 millimetres. So it is superbly round.
Because
as opposed to the Earth, which, although the Earth is jolly round, apart from the flat bits at the top, the point about the Earth is it's actually jolly smooth compared to, say, a billiard ball.
Smoother than a ping-pong ball, isn't
it? Now, why is that, that a snooker ball...
I'm sorry, I did not know there would be a follow-up question.
Yeah.
why is the Earth...
If you were to scale up a snooker ball to the size of the Earth, the mountains and trenches would be hugely greater than our highest mountains or deepest trenches, i.e. the little pits that you can see when you examine a snooker ball closely, if scaled up to the size of the Earth, would be gigantic. So the Earth, in that sense, is smoother than a billiard ball. What is intelligent falling? Joe Brand.
Is it when you see Michael Winner coming towards you? You deliberately trip so that you can squash them.
Very good example. You really got it into the Winster, haven't you?
I have.
Yeah.
Is it because he's not returning your calls, Joe? Let go of it.
Take me out to dinner.
It's intelligent falling what Ronaldo does in the penalty.
No, it's a kind of way of trying to demonstrate what scientists mean by theory. Because, as you probably know, they have in America this idea that it's equivalent to teach intelligent design as it is to teach the theory of evolution. Because they say, well, the theory of evolution is only a theory, so why can't we suggest our theory? Which is a misunderstanding of what a scientist means by theory. That's what...
You've lost me.
Yeah. Well, you've heard of the theory of evolution.
Yes.
And you've heard of intelligent design?
No.
Ah, well, in America, religious people who decide that evolution is contrary to what the Bible says about the creation, they want children to believe that all creation was made by an intelligent being, i.e. God.
The universe is designed by something.
Yeah, and their name for it, rather than saying, just believe the Bible, is intelligent design.
They say,
it's the theory of evolution, so why can't we have a theory of intelligent design? And they can both be taught in the same way. And all I'm getting at is that actually theory has a rather specific meaning in science. It's not the same as guess. It's not even the same as hypothesis. This is what the OED calls a theory. A statement of what are held to be general laws, principles, or causes of something known or observed. I.e., that's not a guess. The theory of evolution is, as far as any biologist or zoologist would say, is true. I mean, it is supported by facts.
So what was intelligent falling? It was...
Intelligent falling is saying, well, Newton had a theory of gravity, but it was overturned by Einstein's theory of gravity. So why can't we suggest our theory, which is intelligent falling?
Isn't the point partly that different theories are supported by different amounts of evidence? So, for example, David Icke has a theory that the royal family are all 7-foot green lizards in 6-foot human skin suits.
Yes.
And he doesn't have a lot of evidence for that theory. Whereas the sort of evolution is supported by a lot of evidence. And if you want to question a theory, then you should do so by challenging its evidence rather than by...
The intelligent design believers, in America, what do they think they put in their cars?
It is a problem. I mean, it's a hard position to be a fundamentalist. On the one hand, you have to forgive people, on the other hand, you have to take their eye out. Which is a bit difficult to know which one you're supposed to do at any one moment.
Well, if Michael Winner's around...
Yeah. Yes.
..to make a decision.
I've got this fantasy of Michael Winner sitting down saying, oh, it's Friday, what shall I do? I know, I'll watch QI. Joe Brand's on. She's my favourite.
Thank you.
Now, what's going on here?
Ooh.
Yay.
Is it half hen, half cock?
It is exactly half cock, yeah. It is exactly that. It's half hen, half cock.
Is
right
a
down.
A freakish accident?
Down the middle. It is
or
a freakish
done
accident.
Done by design.
It's not done by any kind of scientist. It's a rare enough
thing. I literally
thing.
Guessed that because of the theme of the programme.
Well done. Yeah, you see, using your male intelligence once.
Oh, I feel so foolish now.
It's called bilateral. Gynandromorphic hermaphroditism.
I was going to say that.
Yeah. We're dealing with chromosomes again. All cells on one side of the animal, male. All cells on the right, female. Doesn't happen in humans. Oh, I don't know how that would work.
They're quite a good fan, though.
would be fun.
You're
yes.
At a party, you stand that way.
But a clownfish. Do you remember? Did you ever see the film Finding Nemo?
Yes, yes. That's a clownfish. Yes.
A clownfish.
Yes. They're fierce.
They are. They're
I know a bit about them. They have a relationship with that anemone, so that.
Yeah, they're always
normally
living those,
poisonous to other fish, but they are immune to it, and they have their babies in there. And then if you try and get near them, they come at you.
They're quite.
They're quite fierce.
Yeah, they are.
Territorial.
But do you know about their gender assignations?
Is it variable?
It is sort of up to them, yes. What happens is you have one female and one dominant male, and the rest are all rather weakly and not very fit or sexually active males. And if the female dies, the active male then becomes female, and one of the weakling males becomes the alpha male. It's sort of really weird. Isn't that extraordinary?
How extraordinary.
Yeah, they're very unusual like that. Rather splendid. So the story of Finding Nemo and his father would have been a very different... His father would have been his mother by the time he got to him. The whole thing would have been very odd.
Where have you been?
What? It would have been a very strange...
Do you think these animals know that that's what's going to happen to them, or they're just instinct? Do they actually... Does he know, you know, I hope you don't die, because if you die...
I'm going to have to...
Then I have to have it off with all the other blokes. And I'm not into that.
It's a very...
They wake up one morning and go, oh, no, what's happened to me?
Change. The change. It is a very strange thought. Yes, bilateral gynandromorphic hermaphrodites are male on one side, female on the other. Who fancies a shootout with a real-life vortex cannon? I've given you one each next. You've got a box. See that box there? It's simply a box, all right? Now, the hole is where the vortex emerges. So if you lean it so that the hole is pointing at the target, all right, and basically what you're going to do is smack the side of the box, all right? After a 3, 2, 1, smack! Very good. There you are! Now... What are you doing? But what we can... Yes? What we can do before you destroy the box... before you destroy the box, you can do something even more exciting, and that is fill it with smoke, and it will demonstrate what, in fact, was happening with the air. You should all have smoke machines. That's it. Fill it with smoke, fill it with smoke. Fill it with smoke, and now... Look! Just a gentle tap. That is a vortex, a beautiful smoke ring. And a lovely one there. And I've got an enormous cannon here. And I'm going to fill mine with... I'll see if I can get mine across the...
You're going to chase each other.
Across the room here. Here we go. I've got the woman around. We'll let the smoke drift a little. We don't like a big dustbin. It's simply pressure of air creating this wonderful vortex.
No, it's not. It's magic.
Nice work. Basically, ladies and gentlemen, that's it. Hours of fun can be had playing with your own homemade
red and black and a complete racket.
Ooh, Dennis the Menace falling down the stairs.
Extra point.
Thank you, Sandy.
So did you get extra points for being cute?
Yes.
Yeah, good luck with that.
Yeah.
Table tennis rackets.
Oh.
They are, aren't they? Wonder
any shape,
why.
Any size, any weight, but they have to be red on one side and black on the other.
Sorry, any size?
Yes, if you wanted to, you could play with an enormous.
That are you serious?
Yes, so the rule
why
is...
Why wouldn't you?
Because it's difficult.
It's you can't spin
it. No, because the ball's tiny. That's why I'm really
get a
bad
tea tray
at it.
And a broom handle.
Just a mass, any weight and any size.
Yeah, any weight, any size.
You'd have a lightweight one that would be 18 foot in diameter. That's what you'd have.
Just stand at the other end of the table.
And just like that.
But the red and black thing, anybody know why?
Oh, is it so they can also be used to park an aeroplane?
I'm going to see something now, and it's something that someone said to me once. And you can spin it differently depending on the different side.
Yes.
What I was told at the youth club.
Is correct.
Oh,
Susan.
So they introduced this rule in 1986 because players were using rubbers with different characteristics on the different sides, and the opponent needed to see which one you were using in each shot. What happened was, in 1980, there was a player called John Hilton, and he won the European men's singles title, and it was a shock result. And the reason it was a shock result is that he was only the fourth best player at his local YMCA, let alone in Europe. But he had one of these combination rackets, and nobody could work out which side he was using, and what they needed to do was to see which side you were using because it mattered to the opponent. But what we really want to do with our rackets is a little bit of business. So if you look down beside you, there is a table tennis racket, and we can see that they have one red side and they have one black side. Ooh. Now, what I want you to do is hold your rackets red side up like this, OK?
Smells okay. Funny.
Oh, it does.
Oh, yes.
It could get high as a kite.
Oh.
What is that glue?
That's every sports shop you've ever been into condensed into one racket.
That's like Quick Fit going in the back in Quick Fit. You don't need to know what I was doing in the back. It wasn't quick and it didn't fit. Ooh, yeah, baby. Have we got any balls?
No, we're not doing that. We're going to toss them in the air and so that the rackets spin over, and I want you to catch it red side up again.
Whoa.
Okay. So mine's come up black. Black. Can you... Oh, sorry. Mine keeps coming out black.
It's black every time. It's black every time, Sandy. Why is it?
So you cannot do it. Fundamentally, you cannot do it. Oh. If it starts red, it will end up black.
It's so weird.
Look here. We've done a video of somebody rather more adept. And you can see that we flip it and it lands the opposite side each time. Does anybody know why?
Because of the smell.
It's like toast and butter because it's heavier on one side.
No, so you'd think it was something to do with air resistance or gravity or the weight of the thing. There's an American theoretical physicist called Richard Feynman, and he was asked if anybody could explain this in a simple way, and he thought about it for a bit and he went, no. It is called, and I'm going to pronounce it wrong because it's a Russian name, it's called a near enough the Johnny Bakoff effect. He was a Soviet cosmonaut, and he was up in the Salyut 7 space station in 1985. He spun a wing nut in order to remove it from a threaded bolt. It spun right off the bolt. It continued to spin after it had come loose, and it suddenly flipped over and started spinning in the opposite direction, and then it flipped back to the original orientation and kept flipping from one to another. This had never been seen before. Let's have a look at a video. It is the most bizarre thing. So there it is. Look at it.
Oh, wow.
It's in the air, in the simply spinning, and then it starts to spin the other way, and then it spins the other way, and it spins the other way like that.
Is it paired with a wing nut and another galaxy?
This would work with a tennis racket as well. It's to do with it having an axis here and an axis here and an axis here, and this one is the one that we sort of don't think is going to come into play. But it's weird, isn't it?
Yes.
Do you think that humans will ever teleport?
No.
Yes, OK, Holly, why?
If you think about it, 10 years ago we didn't have Uber, and now we've got Uber.
Yeah. And that's as good as teleporting.
Yeah, that's just...
There's been times when I don't remember how I got home, and then I've looked at my emails and I realised I got an Uber receipt, and I thought, that's as good as...
Teleporting. Well, here's the extraordinary thing, is that we have already done it, although not to ourselves. We are heading into quantum physics, but fear not, it is not difficult at all. So quantum physics, essentially the study of extremely small particles, so atoms, electrons, photons, which are...
Molecules.
Light particles.
Light particles.
So in 2017, China teleported information from a photon into outer space using a process called quantum entanglement. So now, let me explain this to you. I want you to imagine this is a single energized photon. What you can do with a photon is you can fire it from a laser into a crystal, and you can effectively turn it into two not quite so charged photons. So you have to imagine now that this is two photons, but they are effectively still the same banana, the same photon. It's just that we have separated them. Now, I'm going to take this bit of it and I'm going to chuck it to you, Carriad. So I need you to imagine that you are in a spacecraft, you are 500 kilometers away from the Earth. You're in a Chinese spacecraft. You ready?
Yep.
There we go. Fantastic. OK.
Tell you what, at least you didn't make a meal of it.
So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to write something on this. And this is the astonishing thing. It is 500 kilometers away. I have written Alan. If you then show yours, imagining that it is now 500 kilometers away, it too says Alan on it. Whatever you did to the photon that is left on Earth, exactly the same thing will happen to the photon that has gone out into space. Wow. And we don't know why. We shouldn't feel bad that we don't know why. Einstein did not understand it at all. It freaked him out. He called it spooky action at a distance.
Oh, I get now I get
So here is the weirder thing. We could pair this bit of banana, if you like, with an orange.
Wait, we're pear, orange or banana?
If I then did something to the orange, mm-hmm. it too would appear on that bit of banana. I'm trying to use fruit as an example, but basically I could pair another photon, a third one, to this one on Earth, but it is still having the same existence.
God, I feel so really weird.
So you basically, when you teleport, you're going to make a version of yourself elsewhere, and then you can do whatever you like to it.
You're right, Alan. The trouble is that we just don't know enough about it.
I do know, though. What I know what it is.
OK.
Two words for you.
Yes.
Fax machine.
What I like is how you've kept so up to date.